They've been around for centuries, saved millions of lives, and helped to eradicate life-threatening diseases. Newer vaccines can even protect against some forms of cancer. But despite groundbreaking advances, many vaccines are still mired in controversy and targets of disinformation campaigns. On this town hall, The Truth About Vaccines, our panel will explain the facts about vaccines and highlight what you need to know to protect yourself.
Thank you to the Eunice Joyce Gardner Charitable Foundation for its leadership support of the Health Channel.
Welcome to the Truth About Vaccines Town Hall. I'm Olga Villaverde, and joining me is Dr. Michael Zinner, CEO and Executive Medical Director of Miami Cancer Institute.
Thank you. Great to be here with you. It's been a tough fall and winter so far, and all kinds of viruses and plenty of people are getting sick.
That's right, Dr. Zinner. In fact, it's not over yet. Here are the latest numbers from the CDC. Take a look at this. So far this season, there have been almost 33,000 hospitalizations due to COVID-19. That's the highest number in a year. And nearly 86% were from the new variant, JN1. There were nearly 400,000 hospitalizations for flu compared to 360,000 last season. So while the numbers look similar to last year's, we still have a ways to go before we're out of the flu season.
That's right. There are still states that the CDC believes are at high risk for more viral activity. That's why taking advantage of the readily available vaccines is so important.
We have a great panel to bring us the truth about vaccines. So let's start by introducing our experts. Let's start with Dr. Carlos Del Rio. He is the Associate Dean of Emory University School of Medicine. Dr. Kavita Patel, she is a primary care physician practicing in the Washington, D.C. area. And Dr. Scarlet Constant. She is a pediatric specialist at Constant Care Pediatrics in Miami. I want to welcome all of you. Thank you so much for being with us in this town hall.
Happy to be with you.
Welcome.
Thank you for having us.
Vaccines have been around for a long time. The first was invented in 1796 for smallpox. Some confusion and misinformation has historically followed the development of any new vaccine. But what's circulating about the COVID mRNA vaccine is much more disturbing, and the misinformation is everywhere.
Take a look at this. A recent survey by the Annenberg Public Policy Center found that 63%, which is less than two-thirds of those surveyed, believe that it's safer to get the COVID-19 vaccine than the COVID disease. 21% don't believe the vaccine is safer than the disease. That number has doubled from 10% since 2021.
This to me is awful.
This is pretty bad.
Yeah. This shows me that the mistrust is getting worse, not better.
You're right. Recently, the Florida Surgeon General called for a halt in the use of mRNA vaccines. In a statement from the Florida Department of Health, Dr. Joseph Ladapo said he is concerned about the risk of contamination to the human genome because of a small amount of DNA fragments in the vaccine. This is what he said, and I'm quoting, "If the risks of DNA integration have not been assessed for mRNA COVID-19 vaccines, these vaccines are not appropriate for use in human beings. Providers concerned about patient health risks associated with COVID-19 should prioritize patient access to non-mRNA COVID-19 vaccines and treatment."
Dr. Del Rio, you and I know the real FDA data here, so I'm having a hard time with what the Surgeon General said. Can you sort out what he's talking about?
Well, Michael, I think it's hard to know exactly what he's talking about because he's confusing many things, right? These vaccines are mRNA vaccines. They're not DNA vaccines. And he is talking about DNA integration. DNA does not integrate like this. So he's using a lot of words. I would say he's using science speak or doctor speak to confuse people and to frighten people. mRNA vaccines have been given to millions of people globally. They have proven to be exceedingly safe. There are some concerns about safety. One of them has to do with myocarditis, primarily in young individuals, primarily in young men. But again, the risk of myocarditis are still smaller than the risk of getting myocarditis from having COVID. And the vaccines have proven to be highly effective in preventing severe disease, hospitalization, and death. So really, it is unfortunate that he's saying this, because those are some of the most effective vaccines for the prevention of severe disease in COVID. Now, if you don't want to get an mRNA vaccine, you can get a protein-derived vaccine. A Novavax has produced a vaccine that has been approved by the FDA and is not an mRNA vaccine. The point is, we need to get people vaccinated, and we need to get people vaccinated with the most updated vaccine, you know, that has been produced for COVID, which is, as Olga mentioned, the JN1 variant is really circulating, and people who have not received the most recent updated vaccine are at high risk of not only getting the infection, but actually developing severe disease, getting hospitalized, and having severe consequences of the infection.
And let me add right here, Dr. Del Rio, that Dr. Ladapo also claims that the vaccine contains the monkey virus, simian virus 40.
Dr. Patel, come on. Any truth to that?
Dr. Patel, I think you have to unmute. Okay, her audio. So let's see if we can fix that. Dr. Del Rio, why don't you take that question, and we'll wait for Dr. Patel.
Well, again, that information is wrong. There's no simian virus in it, and there's no data, there's no evidence to back what he's saying.
And we would totally agree with that, and surprised, in fact, that he made those comments. But let me turn to Dr. Constant. Hearing that these kinds of things that are in a vaccine that could harm our genes is scary, especially for patients and parents who may not understand the science behind vaccines. So how do you deal with their fears? Because it's not true.
Right, that's a great question, because this is something that I'm faced with almost on a daily basis. And what I try to tell my patients is that I'm here to guide them and give them the facts. And I try to explain to them that as physicians, we're trained to practice evidence-based medicine. So I give them the facts the best way that I can. I try to explain to them even just a little bit of like very basic science, just to kind of show them how ridiculous some claims are. And it has been helpful. And I always say that I'm not pushing my own agenda. I don't want to offer my opinion. I don't want to tell them, well, you know, I did it, I gave it to my kids. I really just want them to know from a very unbiased perspective that this is important for you, and I explain to them why. And I just usually try to see if that works, because for the most part, unfortunately, the minds are made up before they come in to speak to me.
Good point there, Dr. Constant. Now, the mRNA vaccine does work differently than many other vaccines. Here's a video that explains how each type works. Take a look.
How do vaccines work? When germs such as bacteria or viruses invade the body, they attack and multiply. This invasion, called an infection, is what causes disease. Vaccines can help protect against certain diseases by imitating an infection. Some vaccines contain weakened versions of a bacteria or virus. Others contain only part of the bacteria or virus. And vaccines, like the mRNA vaccines that fight COVID-19, contain only the genetic material for a specific disease protein. All of these vaccine varieties stimulate the body's immune system to build up defenses against the infectious bacteria or virus without causing the disease. After vaccination, the immune system is prepared to respond quickly and forcefully when the body encounters the real disease-causing organism.
The presence of these antibodies build immunity to the disease and protect us from experiencing serious symptoms or even getting the disease in the future.
For more information on vaccines and vaccine schedules, please visit cdc.gov/vaccines.
Dr. Del Rio, let me bring you in real quick. This type of vaccine has been in research for many years. In fact, in previous town halls, you and I and Dr. Zinner have talked about it. Can you chime in on that, please?
Yeah, I mean, the development of the science behind mRNA vaccines is really an amazing science. And again, it has been researched for many, many years. And it really uses our immune system. Olga, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. We're hearing you perfectly
really
fine.
Uses our immune system ability to produce antibodies by showing it's simply taking a protein of the virus into the immune system and priming the immune system for the production of antibodies. It's a very smart way, and in fact, the people that developed this have been recognized this year with it, you know, this Nobel Prize of Medicine because of this incredible development.
Thank you, doctor. We have a viewer question, and I'd like to take this real quick, Dr. Zinner. It's a comment from Brianna on Facebook, and thank you, Brianna. She writes, if you happen to get the flu shot, then it looks like you are more susceptible to coronavirus infection than a person non-vaccinated. Great question there.
Yeah, Dr. Kossin, can you help answer that question?
So she's asking, if you get the flu vaccine, are you more prone to getting the actual coronavirus?
Yes, than a person that is non-vaccinated. That's exactly what she's asking, Dr. Constant.
Okay. No, I mean, getting the flu vaccine is going to protect you from getting the flu virus, but also getting a vaccination in general increases your immunity, right? So you have these antibodies floating around in your defenses are more equipped to fight a virus. So I've found that those that are getting vaccinated for the flu, actually, it doesn't, well, you're not predisposed to getting COVID, but more importantly, your body is ready to fight whatever virus kind of comes its way. So you're actually in a better position if you're vaccinated.
You know, Dr. Del Rio, let me ask you this. With all of this confusion that's going on, and you're listening to it right now, why is there not one voice from the medical community about the COVID-19 vaccine?
Well, that's, Mike, that's a very, very good question. And I think that we all need to be voices, right? We all need to talk about it. CDC talks about it, the CDC director, but we all need to talk about it. And again, we need to really emphasize that COVID vaccines are effective, are safe. And what the problem we have with COVID vaccines is they're not being used. And I think that's the biggest sort of missed opportunity we have.
All right, thank you, doctor. I want to tackle some misconceptions out there. So, Dr. Del Rio, we've heard that the COVID-19 vaccine has caused thousands of sudden deaths in otherwise healthy people. Is this true or false? My guess is
false.
You want to chime in a little bit more on that and why people even think that?
There's nothing else to say because it is false. There's no evidence to substantiate the claims. It's almost like you're saying to me, there's evidence that the earth is flat. There's nothing else to say other than say this is false. I mean, there's a lot of misinformation out there. And the problem is that misinformation is like a fire hydrant, right? It just puts out water and is really hard to just... Showing people the facts frequently is not enough. What I tell people infrequently, I tell them is, look, I vaccinated myself, I'm vaccinated, my family's vaccinated, my children are vaccinated, my grandchildren are vaccinated. If I didn't think it was safe, do you think I would do that? Do you think I would expose myself and my family to something that I thought was risky?
Good point.
And I will say, I'll echo that. Me, my family, everybody I know, and I agree the same thing. We would not expose them if we didn't believe how important this is. All right, Dr. Constant, let me turn to you for another question, another misperception, in that children can handle the COVID virus well and aren't at risk for severe cases of it, so they don't need the vaccine. Any truth to that at all?
Yep. Right, so I hear that all the time in the office. And I understand what they're saying is that, yes, we have seen, at least anecdotally, even in my office, that the children do handle it better, quote unquote, handle it better. They don't have such severe respiratory symptoms. They're not being hospitalized, although there is obviously a small percentage of children that do get hospitalized, and there is a risk for MIS, as we know. So when patients tell me that, I try to remind them that, you know what, maybe your kid does do well with COVID, but your mother who was taking care of your child might not do so well when your child gives their grandma COVID. So it's also very important to, like, I know that we mentioned this before, and I think it kind of fell flat where we said we need to protect our community, but it's true. You need to protect your community. You need to protect yourself and those around you. So even if your kid does do well, what about the elderly people in your life, or what about the family members that might not do well? So I really try to emphasize that and remind them that there are other factors that we're thinking of rather than just being hospitalized and dying.
Fantastic. We have another viewer question for our panel, and this question says, I recently had COVID and was wondering if I have immunity now and when should I get a booster? And I believe we got Dr. Patel back, so I'm going to have her take this. And Dr. Patel, I also want to circle back to the Florida Surgeon General's comments, because I know you had something to say there, but let's take this viewer question if you don't mind.
Yeah, it's a great question. And so, generally speaking, if you have had COVID, we definitely recommend waiting at least 30 days. I actually have recommended patients wait a little longer, and I've even tried to tell them that we should try to time the booster so that we can have like a sense of when that booster, as you know, doesn't last forever, will be the most protective in those weeks to early months after the booster. So if you've had COVID, you do have immunity and protection. That immunity doesn't last very long, however, and especially right now, like while we're in a surge, I would say that anybody that has been at least 30 to 60 days out, you should think about getting a booster. Even more so, Olga, if you're in kind of an older or someone with conditions that are very common, such as depression, obesity, any of these conditions can put you at much higher risk for hospitalization, making the booster all the more important.
Fantastic.
And then to get back to Dr. Ladapo, I used to work in the government, so I have been very attuned to kind of comments made about substances. And in this case, a comment about simian virus, a fragment of simian virus DNA that is potentially in our, and they called out specifically in the statements that have been made, the Pfizer vaccine, but really any of the mRNA vaccines, the Food and Drug Administration, the European Medicines Administration, which is the European equivalent of the FDA, have all weighed in on this globally to say that there is no DNA in any of our vaccines. And what is unfortunate, Olga, is that people are using the fact that in order to make vaccines, there have been products that are related to simian virus and fragments of DNA that go into the research to help create vaccines. The truth is that what I just ate for lunch today and what I drank in the daytime probably had more fragments of other DNA. So if we're actually that concerned about what's going in our body, I would say turn your attention away from vaccines and probably turn your attention to what you're eating.
Great information.
Kavita, God, I just couldn't believe you could say it any better. Thank you very much. Now, Olga, one of the reasons so many people came down with COVID this season and is because many just didn't get the latest booster.
You're absolutely right, Dr. Zinner. In fact, only about 17% of the total U.S. population has received the bivalent booster dose. For instance, infants and children, it's a little over 19%. Now, that number of adults is almost 21%, and those 65 and older is above 43%. So we have another viewer question about boosters, and they ask, quote, I've had the original two doses of the vaccine and a booster. Why do I need another shot? So Dr. Del Rio, do you want to take this one for me?
Absolutely, Olga. First of all, I no longer like to talk about boosters, right? We don't talk about boosting our flu vaccine. Every year we get an updated flu vaccine. As the viruses evolve, new versions of the vaccine are being developed. And I don't call them a booster, I'm calling it an updated vaccine. So you have received previous vaccines, you need to get now an updated vaccine because the virus has changed. And as a result of that, your protection is not as good with the protection you previously had. So the reason is, you know, as the virus evolves, you got to get a new vaccine. But it's not a booster, it's actually an updated vaccine.
So Dr. Constant, almost a follow-on for that very question is, are people just at vaccine fatigue? Are people just tired of rolling up their sleeves and getting another shot? And if so, what do you do about it? What can we do about that?
Absolutely. Vaccine fatigue has set in, and it has been very difficult. The past year and a half to 2 years has been quite difficult in the office because Not only do I have to talk or encourage the COVID vaccine, more than anything, I'm trying to encourage the regularly scheduled vaccines that used to not be such a problem. You know, we used to have the issue with MMR, and some people didn't really want to give their child the HPV vaccine, but now it's turned into just vaccines in general has been a problem. And so I try to educate my patients. I explain the importance. I explain the fact that they don't see certain diseases because we've managed to, you know, basically eradicate certain diseases in our community because of herd immunity. I have tried every angle. I've explained that we in the United States have the luxury of refusing vaccines because most people have never seen polio in real life. They've never seen, any type of any diseases that have pretty much been eradicated. And therefore, they feel that they are safe and they don't need vaccines. So I have really tried to emphasize the importance of community health, herd immunity, vaccination scheduling, but it has been very, very difficult, very difficult. And I think that, you know, one of the most important things is to, amongst our colleagues, is for us to be on the same page. With all this discord, it's very hard for patients to trust because physicians within my own community, just my own colleagues, have different ideas about vaccines or the COVID vaccine. So when, you know, just like in your home with little kids, if the parents are fighting and can't be on the same page about something, then nobody's going to fall in line in the house. And that's what's happened now with vaccines. They're receiving so many different, so much different information and so many different perspectives. And you know, schools are not requiring it anymore. And the health department can give you an exemption. And everybody's just kind of fallen a little loose about the vaccine scheduling. So it's not that important. Parents don't find it that important, or they wait and they say they're going to read about it and they'll think about it and they'll do it later. And it's been very easy for them to do that. So I think that we need to have a unified front. I think that we all need to, you know, have the same idea, give the same information, and back each other up so that our patients can actually trust us again. Because right now they are not trusting us, and they're not trusting, you know, just announcements that are being put out because they think that whichever company is putting out an announcement has their own agenda, which is not true. So I think we need to really work on our presentation and how we are presenting our information and how we are discussing with each other, you know, the importance of vaccines.
We're going to talk about a few of those things in a few minutes, too. But this year we've been hit pretty hard by the flu. Cases are high, and it's not over yet.
And sometimes it's hard to know which virus you might have, so we want to show our audience a refresher video on the flu and some of its symptoms. Take a look.
ER rooms are increasingly busy across the country as flu cases rise.
Influenza does this, and this is kind of one of those things where it slowly goes up week after week, and then it really hits a peak, and it goes up exponentially for about 3-4 weeks, and then finally subsides.
The flu is a contagious respiratory illness that is caused by influenza viruses. There are two main types of human flu viruses, types A and B, and they're responsible for what we know as flu season each year. The symptoms can include fever, chills, aches, cough, sore throat, and runny or stuffy nose. A mild case of the flu can be treated at home, but it's important to get plenty of rest, stay hydrated, and take pain relievers for a fever. Your doctor could also prescribe antiviral medications. The best way to protect yourself and your family from getting the flu is to get the flu vaccine. It's especially important for those over 65, pregnant women, and people with pre-existing health conditions.
What I can tell you about the flu vaccines right now is that the flu vaccine and the flu virus that's in the community right now are pretty good matches. All right, based on the initial tests. And so this is probably a pretty good vaccine that will protect you from getting the flu. But more importantly, it protects you from getting really, really bad flu, like that gets you in the hospital or puts you on a breathing machine.
The good news here is that a lot of people are getting their flu shot.
That's right. I got mine. And as you say, so did a lot of other people. Overall, the percentage of children getting one dose of the flu vaccine was almost 58%. That's not a change from last season. For adults 18 years and older, it was 50%, but that was a decrease for all adults from last season. And fewer of those over 65 have gotten a flu shot this year.
Dr. Del Rio, there doesn't seem to be as much confusion over the yearly flu shot. Is that because a couple of types of virus are here on a seasonal outbreaks, or is there another reason?
You know, I think, Mike, that we've gotten more used to the flu vaccine, right? If people are used to it, we've socialized it in an appropriate way. And, you know, I wish we could get more people vaccinated. We're still seeing a lot of people with flu. But the reality is that the flu has been much more socialized and is therefore more accepted. We see, I have patients who say, you know, I'm happy to take my flu shot, but don't give me that COVID vaccine. I think we have this sense of, you know, I understand the flu, but I don't quite understand COVID. At some point in time, hopefully we'll have both of those viruses in one vaccine, like we have many other vaccines that combine multiple viruses, and we'll make dealing with both viruses, or even, you know, we haven't talked about RSV, but if you combine it with RSV, maybe you can have a vaccine that covers all three viruses for people over the age of 65. Because again, in flu, I worry, and like in COVID, I worry about the impact of the disease in people over 65. People that I have in the hospital very, very sick with flu are people who are either not vaccinated or who are over 65 and not vaccinated.
Thank you, Doctor. And just to let our viewers know, we will be talking about the HPV vaccine and RSV as well in just a few minutes. But Dr. Patel, I want to stick with the flu here for a moment. Is it true that the vaccine is made with eggs and people who are allergic to eggs should avoid this vaccine?
It is true that the most flu vaccines are made using an egg-based manufacturing process, so it does have a small amount of an egg protein in there, but it is not true that if you have an egg allergy of any severity, that you should avoid the flu. So let me say it even more emphatically, everyone 6 months and older, regardless of severity of egg allergy or no egg allergy, should get an annual flu shot, period. And this is because we've not only studied this and looked at people who have different types of egg allergies, including incredibly severe ones, and have not had any of the kind of problems you would think of, anaphylaxis or an allergic reaction. Having said that, that's why when we give people the flu vaccine or any vaccine for that matter, we like to kind of go over things to look for. And again, doesn't matter what your allergies are, that's just common sense. But yes, go get that flu shot 6 months and above, regardless of egg allergy.
Thank you, Dr. Patel. Very important. Dr. Constan, I want to turn to you on another issue that we hear about or hear from all the time. Some people believe it's not safe for pregnant women to get the flu vaccine. Are there any reasons they should not?
No, it's actually quite safe for pregnant women to get the flu vaccine because the antibodies, the protective antibodies, actually do crossover, and also when they're breastfeeding, they're able to give their protective antibodies to their non-vaccinated babies. So it is a great idea to vaccinate while pregnant. And also remember, you know, our immunity is a little low while we're pregnant, and if they do get the flu, they don't have many options as far as medication to take to combat the flu since they're pregnant. So it is in their best interest to get vaccinated.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Constant. All right. I have a viewer question here, Dr. Zinner. It's from Mr. Brown on YouTube. Thank you, sir. He wants to know if viruses will get stronger if we don't align our forces and get vaccinated. That's a great question.
Great question. Let me turn to Dr. Del Rio. Can you answer that one for us?
You know, viruses are in continuous evolution, and no virus has evolved as rapidly as the SARS-CoV-2 or the COVID virus. But viruses are in continued evolution, and it's really this balance between us, our immune system, nature, and the virus that dictates what happens. The reality is that as we've gotten infected, as we've gotten vaccinated, we have built an immunological wall, and that has caused the severe disease and the deaths from COVID to go down. But we need to continue building that wall. That wall is not going to disappear by itself. And you can do it two ways. You can do it by getting infected, or you can do it by getting the vaccine. The safest way to do it is by getting vaccinated, because that's how you're building the immunological wall that eventually will make this virus, I want to say go away, but at least become more normal, less something that we're concerned about, very similar to how we think about other respiratory viruses. So it's very important that we continue building that wall.
Thank you, sir. All right, Dr. Patel, I'm going to bring in a question, and I'm so glad this viewer is asking this because I get this all the time. And Dr. Zinner, I've asked you the same thing. We hear from a lot of people that they don't want to get the flu shot because it gives them the flu. Can that happen, or is there another reason why some people feel sick? And I'm going to ask this question because I got my first flu shot this year, and I'm glad I did. I did get a little feverish, yucky, but your thoughts?
Yes, so I'm smiling because I think my entire family has had the same reaction you have. So
okay,
first of all,
good.
The flu vaccine itself does not cause the flu. So I think just that's very important because I've even had to deal with this in my own family. Like if I get the shot, I'm going to get the flu because that's been their experience. Much like you describe, Olga, where you've had a sore arm. By the way, we just talked about when you opened about all the viruses happening all at once. That's flu, it's RSV, it's COVID, and a bunch of other coronaviruses that cause the common cold. So it is much more likely that you have gotten some sort of viral illness. And it is possible that even with the flu vaccine, you can still get the flu. But remember, as we heard from the video, what this does is it protects you in the most important ways to prevent death and also to hopefully prevent you from going into the hospital. Remember that that's the most important thing in keeping people healthy and preventing any of those really dire outcomes. So flu vaccine does not cause the flu. And I think it's incredibly important to not look at one experience where you might have had even gotten the flu virus, but you were probably protected in so many ways. And do not let that diminish, not just the people around you, but also the next year, going back and getting that flu vaccine, because each year that vaccine, Olga, is tailored for the most current versions of the flu virus. Just like Dr. Del Rio said, viruses are smart and they're constantly evolving. The vaccine is tailored for that. So just because you get it once doesn't mean you don't need it the next year.
Thank you for setting the records straight. And it was just 24 hours, so it wasn't even a big deal, Dr. Patel. All right, so Dr. Del Rio, here we go. We have a viewer question about the flu vaccine for those over 65, and this one's a good one. She says, quote, I've been taking flu shots since I was a child a few years ago. I got the flu shot for people over 65. I had a reaction and didn't want to take that again. I went back to the regular flu shot until this year where my new doctor insisted that I take the stronger shot. She writes, I felt terrible. I was feverish. I had brain fog so bad I was tripping over my feet. Why did I have such a reaction to that stronger vaccine? I can't wait to hear your answer.
Well, the main reason is because it's a stronger vaccine.
Exactly.
It has a higher dose of it's a stronger vaccine. It has a higher dose of the antigen. And the reason it's used for older individuals because as we age, we develop something called immune senescence. Our immune system is not as good as responding as when we're young, that our immune system is very good at responding and creating protection against infections after an infection or after a vaccine. Once you get older, your immune system ages and is not as good. So by increasing the dose of the antigen, we're trying to give you more of a dose in order for you to respond. But that explains why some people don't feel as well. You know, in a way, maybe this person's immune system is actually still pretty young. She may be 65, but her immune system may be 55. So she may be fine with the normal vaccine. And if that's the case, it's better to take the normal vaccine than not to take any vaccine at all.
Thank you, sir.
You know, it seems that most vaccines have been the focus of at least some misinformation and controversy.
True. And another that has its share is the HPV vaccine, which Dr. Constant mentioned a few minutes ago. But before we get to that, let's take a look at this video that explains what HPV is and who should get the vaccine. Take a look.
You may have heard of HPV, but how much do you really know about it? HPV stands for human papillomavirus and is a common virus that can be spread through skin-to-skin contact during sexual activity. While most people with HPV don't develop any symptoms because the virus can resolve on its own, it can lead to cancers and genital warts. Each year, over 10,000 people get cervical cancer from HPV. Almost 13,000 get mouth or throat cancers. 6,000 get cancers of the anus. Fortunately, HPV vaccination provides safe, effective, and lasting protection against infections and cancers due to HPV. It's a series of three shots that protect against the types of HPV that most commonly cause cancer and genital warts. The CDC recommends that all children ages 11 to 12 should receive the HPV vaccine alongside their other routine vaccines. Catch-up HPV vaccinations for people who were not previously vaccinated as adolescents are recommended for everyone through age 26. The vaccine is most effective when given to individuals before they become sexually active, but it can still benefit those who are. If you're an adult aged 27 to 45 and you have not previously had an HPV vaccine, talk with your provider to see if the vaccine is right for you. For more information, please visit womenshealth.va.gov.
Dr. Patel, we are seeing more HPV-related cancers than we've ever seen before. And we're seeing that at our Miami Cancer Institute in a most common way. But we're hearing some of the concerns about HPV vaccine that there are adverse health effects. Have there been any side effects attributed to the vaccine?
So this is a great vaccine to talk about, not just because we've got decades of information, but we've had studies and trials totaling over about 60,000 individuals in trials, males and females. And then since then, here's a great number that is incredible, but we should have a larger one. 135 million doses of the HPV vaccine have been distributed since this has been approved by the FDA. So we have a lot of experience, and we know that it is not only safe, but any of the adverse effects are some of the ones we talked about with the flu, usually like pain, swelling, achiness at the site of the injection. There can be a fever and kind of a mild illness in the aftermath, like immediately in the day or so following the injection, but none of the serious adverse effects. There have been cases of anaphylaxis that are incredibly rare, so literally one in a million. However, this is, again, another reason why when we administer these vaccines, we want to watch the patient. We want the patient, if they're leaving our office, to also be looking for any signs and symptoms. So simply put, this is not only a safe vaccine, it is one of the most studied safe vaccines that go strict safety testing.
Dr. Constant, let me follow up with you. Some parents think their child is too young to get the vaccine because they're not likely to be at risk for an HPV-related disease at such a young age. How do you answer that concern? And I'm going to be completely honest. My girls are in their 20s now, but I was that mom. I spoke to the pediatrician, and I went ahead. And I know I spoke to you, and I did it. But I even was that mom.
Yes. Yeah.
So how do you address those concerns?
Yes, I remember that. And I tell my patients, so there are two concerns. There's that they're too young, and that sometimes the thought is that they're encouraging sexual activity by protecting them. And then also, I have a lot of parents who would rather that their daughter gets her menstrual period first. They feel like before she starts menstruating, maybe it might affect something in some way. So I have to attack both of those things. First of all, I explain that it is not HPV is not a sexually transmitted disease because, you know, the parents think that you actually have to have sexual intercourse. But if you would remember on the package, it says it's skin-to-skin contact during sexual activity. So I try to emphasize that for my parents and say you don't necessarily have to have sexual intercourse or penetration to get HPV. So that kind of then brings them back and they say, oh, okay, well, wait, I didn't know that. And I said, you know, this is something that's very contagious, and all you need is skin to skin contact. And I stress that so that they understand that we're not necessarily talking about sexual activity, and I'm not discussing that with their child, and I'm not trying to encourage their child to go ahead and be sexually active, but things happen. And secondly, I explained to them that it has no effect whatsoever on puberty and ovulation and menstruating, because that is an overwhelmingly large percentage of my patients have that concern. They say, you know what, let's wait until after she gets her period, but the boy can go ahead and get it. So it's very interesting, but I just try to give them the facts. I explain to them how important it is, and that the sooner we do it, the better, so that when they are truly at risk, they're already protected. And I also explained the very simple fact that the reason why the HPV vaccine is given at the 11-year visit is because it was tested in children ages 9 and above, but we don't see the kids until they're 11. Most of our patients kind of drop off after 7 or 8 because they don't need vaccines for school. And so the frequency of their visits in the office diminish, and we don't get them again until the 11 year. After 11, they kind of start to fall off again, and they don't really come back until, you know, 15, 16. So the reality is that's when we can capture a good percentage of the population. And so I just explained to them, we didn't pick that age because, you know, they're old enough. We picked it because it worked out and it was more convenient for them as well.
Dr. Del Rio, let me ask you another concern about this vaccine. Can it cause infertility in women, and can you address that concern?
Yeah, absolutely, Michael. It is not a vaccine. It will not cause infertility. And I want to stress that the HPV vaccine is actually one of the most studied and most highly effective vaccines. It has an efficacy over 99%. And this is a vaccine that can actually help us get rid of a disease, a cancer called cervical cancer, that you and others have studied a lot and still deal with it. This is a cancer we can eradicate with a vaccine. This is a cancer we can vaccinate our kids and prevent them from getting. If we use this vaccine globally, we can prevent cervical cancer from being a problem anymore globally. We have to use this vaccine. This is really the major tragedy, is that we're not using it enough, because the reality is every time I see somebody with cervical cancer, it's a result of a missed opportunity to vaccinate someone.
All right, thank you so much. All right, we're going to talk now. We mentioned a few minutes ago the RSV virus. So let me go to Dr. Constant, if you don't mind. What do you see in your practice when it comes to RSV? And is it usually thought of as a disease of childhood, if you will? Would you mind chiming in here?
Yes, it is actually, yes, the parents definitely view it as a disease of infancy and childhood, but more so infancy. I think everybody got the message about RSV in infants and the hospitalizations and deaths. So patients are very, very afraid for their young babies. I don't really hear anybody ask me questions about their two-year-old, but they're very concerned for the safety of their infants. So it's absolutely, and I explain to them what it is, and we do see it. I mean, I think about a month and a half ago, you know, I was seeing it every single day in the office, and thankfully I'm able to manage it. But yes, the parents are concerned. They are aware, and they have been asked about the vaccine. It's just that it wasn't as easily available yet this season. So hopefully we can get that, you know, in gear next season.
Thank you, Dr. Constance. I'm going to turn to Dr. Del Rio. So I know that adults can get this too. And the reason I know that is because my neighbors have visited me talking about it, and they've had respiratory syncytial virus. So where do we stand with adults, Dr. Del Rio, and RSV?
Well, the RSV vaccine is a vaccine that has been approved. There are two RSV vaccines, and they have been approved and recommended for two populations. For pregnant women, and you vaccinate pregnant women to prevent their kids from their newborns from developing, from having severe RSV. But the other population is people over 65, and primarily over 65 who have some underlying disease like lung disease, because those are the patients that are high risk of getting RSV and ended up in the hospital, ended up in the ICU, ended up in a ventilator. So if you're over the age of 60, and especially if you have underlying lung disease, like you're a smoker or you have asthma or COPD, you should get your RSV vaccine.
So if we were to ask then your thoughts on who is eligible or who is most liable to get this, since it's not just a childhood disease, Dr. Patel, who would you recommend that get this RSV vaccine?
Yeah, I definitely have a conversation starting at the age of 60 with patients, but I just want to say, like, adults are at incredibly high risk, and not only are there on average about 100 to 150,000 adults hospitalized each year in the United States from RSV. But unfortunately, Mike, as you probably know, 6 to 10,000 each year die from RSV. So we actually have this incredible opportunity. So not just adults of a certain age, adults with chronic heart or lung disease. I also do talk to any of my patients with kind of underlying medical conditions. Notice the theme, we do this with COVID too. And especially, here's a statistic, we have got to increase adults living in facilities like long-term care facilities or nursing homes. Those rates of immunization are still woefully low. They should be as close to 100% as possible, Mike.
Thank you, Dr. Patel. Now, the last vaccine we want to talk about is the one for measles. The vaccine was invented in 1963 and was expanded to include mumps and rubella. Measles was declared eliminated in the United States by the year 2000.
And this one really does bother me. It was also eliminated in England, but since then, there have been measles outbreaks in both countries. Dr. Patel, how serious have these outbreaks been?
I mean, any case of the measles, not only should it be taken seriously, but it should be something where I think all of us in clinical medicine should stop our tracks and take a pause to say, what led to this circumstance that we got to the point where we even talk about an outbreak? So I think that not only the cases in England, but the cases in the United States, those have all signaled, unfortunately, what I would say is what we've had as a theme here, a lot of misinformation and unfortunately a lot of degradation in trust in not just kind of our relationships with our patients as doctors, but in science. And I think that this, to me, measles, the rise of HPV when we have an available vaccine, having to constantly kind of talk about the value of vaccines, we need to keep doing this over and over again, because the infectiousness and seriousness and consequences of the measles are something that, quite honestly, Mike, I'm sure I can tell you a lot of us, even in medical school, hadn't seen cases because it was eradicated. So there's so much on the line, including not just your own health, but the health of the community. One case of the measles truly can result in exponential spread in a community where vaccine rates are low. And unfortunately, we're seeing that across the country.
Thank you, Dr. Patel. Dr. Constant, I'd like you to chime in on this because this could be a very serious disease for children as well, correct?
Absolutely. It's a very serious disease for children. It could lead to hospitalization and even death. And again, I think that the idea is that when you have the luxury of living a life, of never seeing this disease, not even understanding what it is, unless you've gone to medical school, you don't even know what measles are, then it's very easy to say that you don't need the vaccine or you don't need to vaccinate your child for it, because it's just something that is not tangible to them. They just don't understand. When I was in medical school, I never saw the chickenpox. I mean, I grew up seeing the chickenpox, but I never saw it in medical school. And at this point, you have younger generations having children, and they just don't think that this is really a problem. It's something that they've heard about, but isn't really relevant to them in their life today. And I think that's the biggest problem, is that if you don't feel it's relevant to you and it won't affect you personally, that's basically what I'm seeing, then people just don't take it seriously and they just don't feel that they need to do anything about it. So I think it's important that I have these conversations over and over and explain the importance of herd immunity and eradicating diseases. But I also think it's important that as a community, we come together and have one decision as a whole. I remember that my mom truly believed that vaccines were mandated and I could not go to school if she didn't vaccinate me. My parents believe in vaccines, but they weren't getting me vaccinated because they wanted to protect the community and maybe they were afraid of a disease. They were doing it because they wanted to put me in school. But now you don't have that feeling. It's kind of just like this option. Do you feel like vaccinating your child or not? You have it out. And if you give someone that option and you tell them that it's not terribly important, or you make them feel like it's not terribly important and they can totally opt out without any repercussions, then the easy way is just to choose to opt out. And so I do think that that's something that we need to think about in the healthcare community and policymaking and the schools, figure out what can we do to stress the importance again of vaccination and the spread of disease. How can we express to people that, hey, if there's a measles outbreak at your school, that would be absolutely terrible. How can we get people to understand that? It's something that we really need to think about.
Thank you so much, Dr. Constant. We have a viewer question from Brianna, and I'd like to take it real quick. She's asking Dr. Zinner, what's the death rate of measles versus the measles vaccine? Have people died from the vaccine?
I want to turn to Dr. Del Rio, but I also want you to incorporate in that answer, if you will. We know that measles is one of the most contagious, if not the most contagious, of all the infectious diseases out there. So it's a related question. Maybe you can answer both of those points.
Well, first of all, yes, as you say, the measles vaccine is an incredibly effective vaccine. It's an incredibly safe vaccine. And measles can potentially be a very severe disease. But also, measles is so transmissible, Mike, that you need a very high level of measles immunity in the population. You have to be over 95% of the population immunized to prevent cases from happening. Once you drop a little bit, you go below 93%, you start seeing cases, which is exactly what we're seeing right now in Philadelphia, in other communities in our country. Have people died of the measles vaccine? The answer is no. Can people die of the measles? The answer is yes. So yes, you have a risk of dying, you have a risk of severe disease with measles. And I don't wanna see a kid with measles. I don't wanna see somebody with measles, because the result of having somebody with measles is the result of not using a highly effective, readily available vaccine. And that is something that simply makes me very upset. And quite frankly, makes me sad, because we have ways to prevent something like that from happening.
So, Dr. Dory, let me follow on with that, because one myth about the vaccine, the measles vaccine, is that it causes autism in children. Why is this information still out there? It's been debunked time and time again. We know there's no connection, right?
Absolutely. There's absolutely no connection. This is Dr. Andrew Wakefield, which is interesting. Andrew Wakefield was actually financed by people who were suing vaccine manufacturers. But he published a paper in The Lancet that said that the measles vaccine caused autism. That paper has been refuted, that paper has been withdrawn, that paper has been proven to be wrong. And yet that myth persists. You know, once something, when misinformation is out there, it's really, really difficult to get rid of it. And the reality is many of the people in the anti-vaccine movement has used that and continues to say vaccines cause autism. You know, my good friend and our friend, Dr. Peter Hotez, has written a book about his daughter. His daughter has autism, and yet his book is entitled, No, My Daughter Autism Is Not Due to Vaccines. So vaccines don't cause autism. Autism is a very severe disease. I feel bad for parents that have kids with autism, but it's not caused by the vaccines they received.
Thank you so much, Dr. Del Rio. Very good point to make. I appreciate that. Dr. Patel, we have about 4 minutes left on the show. I'd like to turn to the future of vaccines. We've seen how vaccines like the HPV vaccine can prevent cancer. Do you expect to see more anti-cancer vaccines in the years to come? Your thoughts?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's just one of many different kinds of technologies. Vaccine technology took a not just an incredible leap forward with COVID, but built on this decades-long research around mRNA. The reason we didn't have as many mRNA vaccines before, Olga, is because it was highly unstable and hard to mass produce. And we figured it out because the globe needed to do it during a pandemic. And we're benefiting from that, not just with potential future vaccines against cancers, but also using the fact that we understand what works well with viruses that cause cancer, understanding the role of other diseases in helping to progress cancer, and the genetics of cancer itself. So there is not just promise for vaccines in the future around cancer. I'm looking forward. We've talked in the past about HIV. We've talked at many lengths around different diseases and things that we can prevent finally with vaccines. It all has to start, though, with science and trust, and that's what we've been talking about today.
Let me turn to Dr. Constant. As someone who has to explain these vaccines to parents and patients, what could make your job easier? Do you think a government-sponsored campaign is needed here, or other types of help?
Absolutely. I just need to be backed up. I think that a government-sponsored campaign, I think explaining the facts and taking the fear away. There's this fear of unknown. A lot of parents just feel like, well, do we really know what's in there? Do we really know what we're giving our kids? And they're really concerned. I mean, they're genuinely concerned. So, you know, some people will listen to what I have to say, but, you know, then it just becomes, you know, do I trust just Dr. Constant? And it shouldn't be that way. You should trust the community and trust our movement. And so I do think that we need to kind of, like I said before, have this unified front, have a government-sponsored some type of announcement or education, or take away all of these, you know, stories of infertility and autism and sudden death, things that are not even backed up. They don't even have any evidence behind them. We need to somehow get rid of those horrible, horrible myths so that people could move forward and actually look at the facts and make a correct and educated decision. I think the problem is most parents don't feel that they're making a decision based on substance. They're just very concerned about the bad stories that they're hearing that might be a random person or a random neighbor, and then they just get behind that. So I really do think that I think that as a community or as physicians, we need backup. We need people to back each other up.
Great final thought there.
Well, we've covered a lot of material in this hour, and I'm sure we could even talk some more. So we'd very briefly like to hear some final thoughts from our panelists. Well, let's start with Dr. Del Rio.
Dr. Del Rio, we have about 20 seconds.
Well, vaccines are amazing, and I would say be thankful that we have vaccines. They have allowed us to not see diseases that we saw many years ago, like polio and many others that would kill people, variola, smallpox. Use vaccines. Don't misuse them. Don't deny them. Vaccines are incredible, and they have allowed us to vaccines have allowed people to become adults.
Thank you, Dr. Del Rio. Dr. Patel, about 10 seconds.
I couldn't say it better, and it's never too late to get them. So go out and get them now if you're listening.
Thank you so much. This has been really an informative hour, Dr. Zinner. Well, we've covered
on to what Dr. Patel just said, I will say.
Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry, accessibility, because after 18 years of age, it's very difficult to get a vaccine because adult physicians and GYNs don't tend to carry them. So once they leave me, it sometimes is too old because they don't know how to get them. So maybe we could be better about educating our community as to how to get vaccines if you're not going to your pediatrician.
Thank you so much, Dr. Constant. Thank you to all of you. We really appreciate everything you had to say here. We've learned a lot here. On behalf of Dr. Zinner and myself, we'd like to wish you a wonderful evening. Take care. And what's the message here?
Please get vaccinated.
We'll see you next time.
Thank you to the Eunice Joyce Gardner Charitable Foundation for its leadership support of the Health Channel.